Good evening.
Thank you. What a great house. My name is Colum McCann. Thank you very much. I am so happy to be here for lots of different reasons. First and foremost, because I get to introduce a hero of mine, Terry Tempest Williams. Secondly, because I get to meet all the people from the Lannan Foundation who have really changed the landscape of literature, who have allowed artists, yes. It's such a wonderful thing. So my first time to be here, but and also they allow that incredible sense of community. And the third reason why I'm happy to be here is because, guess what? I'm in Santa Fe. It's such a cool place. I made a big mistake about 30 years ago, actually even more, 31 years ago, I'm showing my age, when I was taking a bicycle across the United States, and I came through New Mexico, and I was coming in from Texas, and I had a chance to come to Santa Fe. Instead, I went up over the Raton Pass, that's a mistake at the best of times, and into Colorado, and didn't get back here for a few years, but I bet you if I'd have come through Santa Fe, I probably would have ended up staying. It's a beautiful, beautiful place. So thank you so much for inviting me here. And in order to introduce Terry, I want to invoke the story of another hero of mine who was also a Lannan fellow, a man by the name of John Berger. Yes, thank you. John. Although John, if I looked upwards, John would say, I'm not up there, I'm down here somewhere. I got to know John quite well through writing letters back and forth to one another. But the first time I got to meet him, I went to, he was in Paris, and he met me at the train station in Saint Anthony, and we walked back through the streets, and you know, we had a lovely evening, we sat around, and we ate, and we drank wine, and then we drank some more wine, and we drank some more wine, and in I suppose in Irish parlance, we were a little bit overserved. And I said to him, you know, the way you do when you're a bit gone, I said, John, where are you from? And he's like, well, I'm from England, you know. He's like, no, I know, because I was able to quote all his lines and stuff. I said, no, but where are you from? You know? And he looked at me, he says, he waited a long time, because he used to consider all his words, beautiful man. He said, I am a citizen. He said, no, I am a patriot of elsewhere. And I thought, how beautiful is that? How beautiful is that? And I know that John liked the work of Terry Tempest Williams. And here we are, compatriots of elsewhere. And I get a chance to introduce her tonight. I am so delighted by it. Thank you. Look, I could go through all the facts. She grew up in Salt Lake. She still lives in Utah and also in Jackson Hole. Actually, I spent the night in jail in Jackson Hole. That's a long story. You know, she's married to Brooke Williams, who's here tonight. They've been married for over 40 years. I don't believe it. It can't be true. That's just one of those alternative facts that are cropping up these days. There's no way they can be married that long. She's written Lord knows how many books. She's written children's poetry. But among them, some of my favorite works of literature, there's Refuge, there's Desert Quartet, Leap, Red. Oh my gosh, sitting beside my son's bed for the past 2 or 3 years, my 17-year-old son, The Open Space of Democracy, he quotes from it all the time, an extraordinary examination of who we are and our politics. Finding Beauty in a Broken World, and does she ever find beauty in a broken world? And most recently, The Hour of the Land, brilliantly stitched together examination of our heritage through our national parks. I felt upon reading it that I was once again out under the stars, whether it be in Big Bend or all these different national parks that Terry brings us to. She essentially says that what she stands for is what she stands on. And I was reminded many times of the necessity of her voice. And then I thought of a quote from an Algerian poet by the name of Tahir Dajout, who was gunned down by fundamentalists in the late, 1980s in Algiers. He says, "If you keep quiet, you die. If you speak, you die. So speak and die." This is what Terry has been doing for a long time, not dying, thanks be to God, but speaking out, knowing the necessity of voice. She has a Guggenheim, she's won a raft of awards, the International Peace Award, the Wallace Stegner Award, but I can guarantee you that she has never written with an award in mind. Her real reward is the fact that you guys are here, it's her readers, and whatever change that you bring about in the world from what she happens to sort of accidentally almost excavate from that beautiful imagination. But facts are mercenary things. We can pack them up wherever we want them to go to. The real fact of the matter is that she is a national treasure. And why is that? I think it's because she lifts the veil on the familiar. She brings inside things that others want to leave outside. She opposes orthodoxy. She restores that which is devalued by others. She opens up all the windows of any room she walks into, including that grand room of the sky. She weaves deeply human structures in a world of wildness and wilderness. She gives us access to our own imaginations and what defines us as human beings, connecting us to one another, giving us reasons for us to question and reasons and ways for us to survive. She finds in the ordinary a very fragrant tenderness. She allows us witness. She is one of our hidden saints, a Lamed Vatnik. She bears the sorrows of the world. She illustrates the close proximity of happiness and love to that of pain and sorrow. She stands beyond coercion and intimidation. She does the things that do not compute. Oh God, does she do the things that do not compute? She tears down fences. She is subversive of ease. She rebuilds then these fences with light and with glass. She's aware that the known grief is so much better than the unknown grief. She makes justice from reality. She creates a path to vision in the dark. She is suspicious of that which gives us too much consolation. She is as tough as basalt and soft as clay. She can be reckless. She can rush headlong. She knows how to get lost. She has weathered illness. She sometimes abandons herself only to always come back around again. She embraces that difficulty of return. She can be as dark as she is light because she knows that the value of light comes from darkness. She is adored by other writers for allowing this light. She knows that we get our voices from the voices of others. Matheson, Abbey, Peacock, Dillard, Thoreau, Williams. She is chain lightning to a whole generation of young writers. She refuses to live in stunned submission to the times at hand. She helps us understand the price we pay and the price we will pay when we dare to make choices. She opposes cruelties. She imagines immensities. She justifies a proper rage. She is vivified by failure and even the prospect of collapse. And she knows, Terry Tempest Williams, that the only things worth doing are the things that might possibly break your heart. Here she is, Terry Tempest Williams.
Thank you, Colum, and thank you for being here tonight. I'm nervous. I'll calm down, but I'm so grateful that you're here. And Brooke and I are thrilled to be back in home ground, New Mexico and Santa Fe. I love Colum McCann. You can see why. We met through Narrative 4, which is a story exchange. And what I love about Colum, among so many things, is his absolute unfettered joy and his lightness of spirit, his love of song, and his depth of conscience and consciousness. Colum, thank you for your generosity of spirit always. It's such a gift to share this evening with you, and I'm so excited that we got to bring him west. Your stories are a healing balm in these uncertain times, and no one escapes your fierce conscience on the page. Consider these words from his most recent book, 13 Ways of Looking. Quote, "To bend, to shape, to break the truth, have I become the liar I never wanted to become?" And then this, "Too many uncertainties, so that even the absolute certainties, the day of the week, the tie of a shoelace, the rhythm of a prayer, have been called into question." And yet, there is something, and I believe it is rooted in story, that is certain, that is restorative, especially now, which is why we have gathered here tonight in pursuit of cultural freedom. A few gratitudes, certainly my deepest gratitudes to the Lannan Foundation, to Patrick for his ongoing support of all things beautiful, wild and free, from literature to art to public discourse and the wisdom of Indigenous people. We are all the beneficiaries of Patrick's vision. And to Larry, his nephew, and his wife, thank you. As I've told you before, you know, really the Lannan Foundation has saved my life repeatedly for their support and faith when really I had none, had little. And to Barbara Venturello, bless you for your care and the beauty of your correspondences. You've been my map for so many years. To Martha Jessup, who made it possible to really write and think and create the Hour of Land when I needed that kind of quiet, where it is only out of that kind of solitude that words can appear. To Sarah Knopp for your activism, your activist heart, and to Don Ushner for his perception. Again, without the support of this community, I don't think I would be here as a writer. The belief in language, the belief in contemplation has allowed so many of us to give voice to what we didn't think we had voice for. To all of you here tonight, thank you. Brooke and I feel so blessed by Santa Fe over and over again. You know better than anyone that magic happens here. From Dorothy Massey of Collected Works, to the grace of Lorene Mills, to the seasoned friendships of Bill DeBuis and Joanna Hurley, to the vision of Nina Simmons and Kenny Ossabel, to the spiritual grounding of Larry Rasmussen, and the graceful leadership of Jim Anote, and to the brave work of Shubhankar Banerjee, David Noble, Mary Del Rubenstein, and Miguel Gandert, to the inspiration of Margaret Card and Lawrence Voder, and all things Vermilion. We are at home in the Rio Grande Basin. I just want to thank you. So thank you for holding this space with me tonight on International Women's Day in this strike moment. Quote, "We wanted arrival to be instant because we didn't want to be separate from what we loved. Wireless, weightless, and omniscient is how we refined our machines. We had a dream that we could smash the bands of matter and time and still be alive. Was that the soul wishing we would invent the body out of existence? So many of us now, enthralled by doom." Dana Levin, from across the sea, one of your poets. Enthralled by doom, a phrase I know very well, especially since the past election. I don't assume that we all share the same politics. I know, coming from Utah, that we most certainly don't. But I will be honest, this is where I've been since the election. Just ask Jennifer Levin, the fine journalist I spoke with from the New Mexican. I literally could not answer her questions because I couldn't see my way through any answers, only my own state of erosion. These are the words that came to me on the morning of November 9th, 2016, on the banks of the Colorado River. Erosion. It is morning. I am morning. And the river is before me. I am a writer without words who is struggling to find them. I am holding the balm of beauty, this river, this desert, so vulnerable, all of us. I am trying to shape my despair into some form of action, but for now, I am standing on the cold edge of grief. We are staring at a belligerent rejection of change by our fellow Americans, my family, who believe they have voted for change. The seismic shock of a new political landscape is settling. For now, I do not feel like unity is what is called for. Resistance is our courage. Love will become us. The land holds us still. Let us pause and listen and gather our strength with grace and move forward like water in all its manifestations. Flat water, white water, rapids and eddies, and flood this country with an integrity of purpose and patience and persistence capable of cracking stone. I am a writer without words who continues to believe in the vitality of the struggle. Let us hold each other close and be kind. Let us gather together and break bread. Let us trust that what is required of us next will become clear in time. What has been hidden is now exposed. This river, this morning, this moment, may we be brave enough to feel it deeply and then act. Action is the antidote for despair. Beauty is its own form of resistance. This is what I want to focus on tonight in the next 40 minutes or so before Colum and I sit down in a spirited conversation. Last night, I had the enlivening experience, and you have to understand how serious this is coming from Utah, where I can't even enter into the Utah legislature without either being stoned or ignored or irate and being escorted for fear of what I might do. But last night, we had the incredible experience of visiting the Roundhouse with Lorene Mills and seeing the legislature in action. And visiting specifically one of the newest state representatives, Nathan Small from Las Cruces. I love Nathan Small, and I really predict he will either be governor of this state of enchantment or perhaps a senator when your brilliant senators retire. We met more than a decade ago at Wooster College in Ohio when he was a student, and I had been warned by the host that there was this young man who was a bit disturbing and obsessive. And she said, "We will try to protect you from him." And I said, no, don't worry. And then as I was walking to where I was staying, this young man with a ponytail leaped behind a bush. And he said, "Sentiment without action is the ruin of the soul." I love Edward Abbey. And I said, "Well, I love you for loving Edward Abbey." And we left campus, and we went into this slough, and we looked for turtles and all manner of Ohioan wildlife, and we barely made it for dinner. And I promise you, I had all sorts of terrifying things in my hair. Nathan Small, we've been dear friends ever since. We worked with him at the Murray Center as the next generation. And I think then, when he was a young man in his 20s, we recognized that he really was the leader of his generation. And to see him last night on the floor, to see him representing not just New Mexicans, but Westerners in this desire for renewable energy, to think about ethics, and to think about how, since Utah has said goodbye to the outdoor industry, Nathan Small and another senator have introduced a bill to welcome them here. I love that it is people like Nathan who are choosing to inhabit this open space of democracy and keeping it open, and that they are still half wild. And I love that Nathan, you know, I remember a conversation with him growing up in New Mexico, and it was about supporting people on the margins and understanding what white privilege is. And I just view him as my teacher, and last night was really a great thrill. But you in New Mexico have always been examples to those of us in the interior West of what a reflective type of activism looks like, whether it's from establishing our first wilderness area in the Gila, or whether it's concerns over nuclear waste and WIP, Los Alamos, your history, our history in the nuclear West, understanding the powers and complexity of cultural diversity in an open society, from the Pueblos to the Hispanic communities that now comprise over 46% of the state's population. And you honored these identities in art, in community celebrations, in civic engagement and politics. As a Utahn, we have a long way to be able to go to follow your lead and emulate your inclusivity and pursuit of cultural freedoms. I know there's shadow sides here. I know it's not easy, but I can tell you, coming from a state that is literally at war with itself, this week that we have been here has been a breathing space. But can I keep thinking, maybe we'll just cross the border and live here on behalf of our own sanity. And with senators like Tom Udall and Martin Heinrich, it is very tempting. And just last Friday, I had the longest conversation with Senator Udall, with Tom. And as you know, we have a long history with Dear Stuart. And Jennifer, I know you loved him. We all did. And Tom was talking in a way I'd never heard him speak before, of what's really happening in the Senate, in the House, and how crucial it is to have our voice. Not voice as in victims of immigration, criminal, whatever E stands for, that our president has set in motion. And I think that right there is a clue that what they fear most is voice. And so they try to denigrate it into something of victims and criminals. I've never heard Tom so eloquent about why we need to speak. I was fascinated by when he said that prior to the election, their office would receive, and I'm sure you know this, maybe up to 50 calls, now well over 500. In the state of Utah, yes. And in the state of Utah, we can't even get through to our congressmen and senators. But each of us carries our home ground within us, first and foremost as Westerners, and our state boundaries dissolve as together we hold our public lands as part of our inheritance as American citizens. The power of what binds us together rather than what tears us apart becomes a shared priority. A creative tension between needs, both human and wild, must be considered and negotiated. An unexpected harmony begins to emerge as something to be honored and safeguarded, like water in the desert. But it isn't easy, as you well know. Our public lands are under siege, Chaco Canyon, and especially in Utah. Bears Ears National Monument, now at risk of being rescinded or at the very least gutted alongside Grand Staircase Escalante National Monument. This is where we are. I want to tell you a story that I've not told publicly, but I do want to share it with you. In the fall of 2015, I was working at the University of Utah in the Environmental Humanities graduate program with 15 students. And we applied for a grant, and we received it from the Compton Foundation, and it was called Reading the Book Cliffs. The Book Cliffs are among the most remote areas in the lower 48. It's also the site of where the first tar sands mine is in the United States of America. And it is being built even as we speak. Our project was to look at the Colorado Plateau, particularly in Utah's section, and look at fossil fuel development and its effect on environmental humanities, on communities, on culture, and to see where it might lead us. The students spent time in Vernal, Utah, learning about how the mortality rate was skyrocketing of babies, until it became a cover story for the Rolling Stone. A midwife who broke the story saying, something isn't right here. Too many babies are dying. Fracking. You know this story well. They were able to go and see the tar sands, even though we were the owners, the company, the corporation would not allow us to speak to them. They didn't feel it was in their best interest. We went over into Moab on the edge of Canyonlands and Arches National Park and saw the methane being flared on up at Big Flats. And we talked to tribal leaders from Jonah, Yellowman, Diné in the Navajo, in Navajo country, as well as Willie Gray Eyes. We talked to Ute leaders talking about indigenous rights and their view of climate change. The students were transformed by the people they met and what they saw, call it ground truthing. And they decided in February at the Bureau of Land Management, the BLM's quarterly oil and gas auction, to help organize and lead the protest. I want to back up a month or two prior. I found myself in Paris for the COP21 conversations. I was working with Sustain Us, a group of young leaders that were brought together through the United Nations. And in the middle of the night, received a call from one of my former students, Morgan Curtis, who asked if, with another elder, would witness their dilemma. Do they behave themselves, or do they engage in direct action? I saw the tension. The next day was the Red Line demonstration. I was with Rebecca Solnit, and together with tens of thousands of people from all over the world, we walked, we marched from the Arch de Triomphe to the Eiffel Tower. And then something happened. I remember when they rolled out this quarter-mile-long banner that said, keep it in the ground. And as we were coming around the corner, I could see the Eiffel Tower, and something in my heart said, enough. This is not enough for me. And I left the group, sat down on the lawn, closed my eyes, and transported myself back to Utah, to the Red Rock Desert. For me, ground zero. And it was there somewhere in my soul I made a vow that I would go home and that I would try to keep it in the ground where I lived. Brooke and I went to the oil and gas auction, certainly with the leadership of Tim DeChristopher. Last time many of us met, Tim was speaking, and I had the pleasure of introducing him and being in conversation. As you know his story, he bid up the oil and gas leases. It was 2008, the prices were high, $1.3 million worth and tens of thousands of acres. Long story shorter, he ended up in prison, 2 years in a federal prison, a student who was only trying to save his future, his generation's future, a livable future. Tim walked with us spiritually. What can I tell you? I got in the wrong line. I'm an introvert by nature. So all the activists were in one line. There was a very short line. I filled out what I thought were the proper documents. And I found myself sitting with the oil and gas companies. Brooke looked a little concerned. There was nothing I could do. Maybe there was nothing I wanted to do. I trusted in that moment that here's where I was supposed to be. The activists started singing, disrupting. They were asked to quit. They continued during the auction, and then they were dismissed. My relationship in that moment, because Utah's a small town, Agent Love, who I knew from Tim DeChristopher's trial, said to me, Terry, are you aware that if you misrepresent yourself, you could go to prison? And I said, I'm aware as an American citizen that I have every right to be here in this auction and bid on these leases if we can pay for them. In that moment, when another agent came up and said, what energy company are you representing? And what came into my mind was Tempest Exploration, LLC. And then when he said, what kind of energy are you going to develop? What came out of my mouth was, you can no longer define energy for us, because the energy we're interested in developing is to fuel a movement to keep it in the ground. For the next half hour, I listened to some of the most vile language I have ever heard about the land that I knew, the land that Tim DeChristopher went to prison for, the land that all of us are sacrificing because of greed, and in many ways, our lack of choices and our own complicity. It was sexual, it was derogatory, it was violent, and my math skills weren't good enough to keep up with what ones I could purchase, because I didn't know if we had enough money to cover the bids. But as I listened, I grew sicker and sicker, and the tears began streaming down my cheeks, and then it was over. And a woman came up to me and she said, what a fraud you are. You had no intention of buying any of these leases. It was theater. And I turned to her and said, no, actually, we're waiting for the remnant sale, because now after the auction, American citizens or the corporations can go into the BLM office and purchase leases, our public lands, for $1.50 an acre, less than a cup of coffee, which is exactly what Brooke and I did. We went into the BLM office, we got out maps, we looked at the leases that were still available in our own county, Grand County, and we found two that mattered to us. One was 14 miles northwest of Arches National Park, and the other was in the Book Cliffs, where we had been with our students, very close to the tar sands mine and within view of Dinosaur National Monument. We were able to purchase, with a debit card, 1,120 acres. We were direct and honest with the BLM. We said we had no intention of drilling for oil until science could prove to us that the fossil fuels on this land were worth more above ground than below ground, given the costs of climate and to our future. 9 months later, after we had to fill out, it was like an essay contest. If you fulfill these essays, then you'll get your leases. If not, Brooke was the one who did the heavy lifting on that, talking about social costs. 9 months later, we received word from the Bureau of Land Management that our leases were denied on the basis of our intent, which is a double standard, because so many of the oil and gas companies that I was sitting next to, the men, and they were mainly men and women, there had no intention of drilling for oil or gas until the price of oil went up. We have now appealed this decision with the Department of Interior and the Board of Land Appeals, alongside issuing a Freedom of Information Act to learn of their decision-making process. But here's the strangest thing. When Brooke and I went to visit our leases in the Book Cliffs and the ones just outside of Arches, what we realized is that really what these leases allowed us to do, by owning them was to destroy the integrity of these beautiful lands, to drill or frack or mine them. In truth, what we realized is these lands already belong to us, we the people. We just wanted to let them rest. While we were there, Badger appeared, a blue-eyed badger, with his, her medicine of minding roots and knowing when to appear above ground and when to disappear below. Always fierce, a shapeshifter, always digging deeper. I am now thinking about badger medicine. So what are the costs to be a citizen at this moment in time? Tim DeChristopher served 2 years in federal prison. I lost my job at the University of Utah. 2.5 weeks after purchasing our leases, I received a note from the new dean of humanities with an email that said, "Dear Terry, due to a change in policies and procedures, it may be difficult for you to move forward. Please see me at my office on March 11th. Again, I have not talked about this publicly. I went, I met the new dean with the University of Utah attorney. It was there that I was informed of the following. Thank you for your service. We are paying you $20,000. Here's a platinum pillow insurance policy, and you are no longer teaching here." I fought it for 6 weeks privately, and then when I was about to sign a new configuration of a contract to the very program that I had started with the prior dean, Robert Newman, 15 years ago, I agreed to early retirement, a reduced salary, and I said, "If you can get me the contract on Monday, I'll sign it." On Saturday, I received a call from the attorney who said, "Terry, we feel that you are out of compliance with the rules and regulations of the university, and if you are to continue, you will not be able to take your students on field trips to the desert. You will be confined to this classroom in Salt Lake City, Utah." And it was at that point that I resigned. I tell you this because this is what we're up against. And I would be lying if I didn't tell you that it forced me into a dark night of my soul. Family relationships were strained. Brooke and I went home to my father's house where we were staying. He looked at me and he said, "You have made a mockery of our family business." My family business is a pipeline contractor who lays pipe for natural gas so that our homes can be heated. We were asked to leave. Before we left, we said, "Can we just stay till tomorrow morning?" We had a very strained dinner, as you can imagine, and Brooke, being much wiser and more under control than I was, said to my father, "You know, John, I know that your heart was broken when Steve died, my brother who was took over my father's part of the business with his cousin who took over my uncle's business. It's very, you know, family, right? Steve died, our family side of the business went to my uncle's side, and my father and brothers were left with no more ownership. It broke my father's heart twice to lose his son that he had put all of his faith in to continue this legacy in the American West, and then twice again when he lost the business. What Brooke said to him was, "John, maybe what you didn't realize is that the Tempest legacy will come through the lineage of your daughter." My father left the table, and we did not see him. The next day, as we were leaving, my father walked outside to say goodbye, and he said, "Excuse me, God damn it, you kids are so naive. Somebody's got to take over this with some sense." And he said, "I know these bastards. I've worked with them for 50 years. Yes, I will be the president of Tempest Exploration to save you from yourself." And so my father now is head of Tempest Exploration, if you can believe it. So these are the moments of transformation that we can't anticipate. And the most amazing thing is during the Women's March, my father went. And when I said, Dad, I can't believe you were at the Women's March in St. George, Utah, and he goes, it really burns me up. It wasn't just about women. So here's the truth, and please bear with me, and I hope this isn't self-indulgent. So I haven't been able to write or even see my way forward since February 16th. Erosion, grief, anger, confusion, depression, all of this until, would you believe me, yesterday? And here's what happened. You all live in Santa Fe, so you know this happens all the time, right? But Brooke and I wanted, I'm now going to tell you a story that I'm going to call the turquoise triangle. And it has to do with the serendipity and grace of the energy here in your community. Yesterday, Brooke and I wanted to stop by and see the Nyman Gallery. We met Michael Naminga, son of Francis, and Dan Naminga, and brother to Arlo. As many of you know, this is Michael Naminga's work. Michael Naminga lives and works here. He is New Mexican from a family of artists, a multidisciplinary artist with a spare contemporary aesthetic, a keen observer of today's society. He creates a compelling mix of imagery and words, commenting on modern interpersonal relationships and popular culture. His current body of work explores the vanishing and changing landscape of the American West. We walked through the gallery and were so moved by the art, the paintings, the sculptures, and his contemporary work, even reconfiguring words like trust. But then there was this shard of truth hanging on the wall. A black and white aerial photograph from Google Earth Maps of the Grand Canyon with a turquoise triangle cut through the arid landscape. It was Michael's piece, part of his Escalade series. In Michael's own words, and he's here tonight, and Michael, bless you and your mother, and he allowed me to read his artist statement that goes it's this. He says, I begin this body of work in 2014 after exploring an area south of Santa Fe called the Galisteo Basin. It is a picturesque southwestern landscape with sweeping vistas and valleys surrounded by juniper and pinyon tree and dotted mountains. I began to photograph an approaching rainstorm from the roadside and noticed small signs that read no oil in Galisteo. As I returned home, I began to do research into the signs I saw and discovered that the tiny village of Galisteo was battling with oil companies, wanting to come in and begin oil exploration in the area. I took the photographs I'd taken and began to place blocks of color over pieces of the landscape. I used these blocks to represent a piece of the landscape that may not be there sometime, someday. I also began to research color psychology and choose colors that have calming effects on people. Because when I'm out in nature, I get that feeling of calmness and serenity. However, these are also the feelings that could be lost in the not-so-distant future. This series began to evolve into a more complicated composition after I heard a lecture he said from Donald Judd at the Dia Foundation. I wanted to create a sense of dimension out of a two-dimensional plane, so I began to have my image's face mounted to a shape piece of plexiglass with different mounting points on the back so that you could change the perspective of the piece. The second series in this body of work centers on a proposed billion-dollar development to go on into the eastern edge of the Grand Canyon, known as the Escalade Project. This area is sacred to both the local Native American tribes of the Hopi and Navajo. With these compositions, I used a shape of color intersecting with an image to represent the desecration of the land. And here you see this. When I saw this, I saw my own home ground too. When I saw this, I saw that turquoise triangle as the lands, the public lands, earth, the pieces, the part of earth that are being cut out, removed, desecrated, destroyed. For the first time in over a year, I could breathe. I could finally see my words in geographic relief, in a collaborative light, not an isolated one. Michael's turquoise triangle became representative of all that we have been working toward. The land that's been cut out, removed, fracked, fouled, gutted from our public lands. Through fracking, drilling, mining, and discounting the integrity, the necessity of our public lands and why we must protect them, because they protect us from ourselves. Be it an Escalade development with a tram from the rim of the Grand Canyon down to the bottom, very near the Little Colorado, the place of origin for Hopi Sipapu. To the rescinding of Bears Ears National Monument by Utah's congressional delegation, to the jagged turquoise triangle that has cut through the heart of Utah's book cliffs in the name of tar sands in times of drought. And it's not just on the ground, but these turquoise triangles, purple, pink, are cutting through our own language. These words have been removed from the new version of the Oxford Junior Dictionary. Acorn, adder, almond, apricot, ash, beaver, beech, beetroot, blackberry, bloom, bluebell, boar, bramble, bray, bridle, brook, bullock, buttercup, canary, canter, carnation, catkin, cauliflower, chestnut, clover, county, cowslip, crocus, cheetah, colt, cygnet, dandelion, doe, drake, fern, ferret, fungus, goldfish, gooseberry, minnow, mint, mistletoe, monarch, mussel, nectarine, newt, oyster, panther, parsnip, pasture, pelican, poppy, porcupine, porpoise, primrose, prune, raven, rhubarb, spinach, starling, stork, sycamore, terrapin, thrush, tulip, violet, walnut, weasel, willow, wren. Gone. These are the words that have been added. Allergic, analog, apparatus, attachment, bilingual, block graph, block, boisterous, brainy, broadband, bullet point, bungee jumping, cautionary tale, celebrity with a capital C, chat room, chronological, classify, colloquial, compulsory, conflict, cope, creek, creep, cut and paste, database, donate, dyslexic, EU, Euro, export, idiom, interdependent, MP3 player, negotiate, trapezium, vandalism, voicemail. And when the editor of the Oxford Junior Dictionary was asked why, she said, because these words no longer have a role in our children's childhood. Who benefits? If we can remove words from a dictionary that are so alive with meaning and withhold them from our children, removing what is alive in the world becomes easy. The wild is no longer part of our vocabulary. I hear the great poet W.S. Merwin's words, "Through all of youth, I was looking for you without knowing what I was looking for." Nature becomes a forgotten language. These are difficult times, transformative times, times of extreme actions, especially within our public lands and our national parks. Extreme drought, extreme fires, extreme development with extreme policy shifts needed in the name of global warming. The world is changing dramatically, both ecologically as well as politically. But I believe our greatest transformation as a species will be spiritual. The word "we" must include all species. So I want to close with two stories, and then we'll have a conversation. The "we" must include all species. What happens if this turquoise triangle cuts in to the lives of monarch, grizzly, bison. 2 years ago, Brooke and I celebrated our 40th wedding anniversary. We were so excited that we had made it this far against all odds. It was entering the realm of the miraculous. And so we said, where do we want to go? And both of us at the same time said Yellowstone. And that's where we went. We went up into the northern part of Yellowstone in the Lamar Valley. Maybe many of you have been there. We arose before dawn. We went into the Lamar Valley in that wonderful crease of crepuscular hours where light, you don't know if you've entered dawn or dusk or dawn. And suddenly this first shaft of light, and we began to see the mist rise, and you could see the gleam of sunlight, dawn just striking the Lamar River. Upon further examination of the country before us, we saw this mound. And with our binoculars, we could see that it was a carcass, most likely a bison. About that time, a park ranger came up and told us the backstory, that in fact, it was a bison, a female bison, a mother bison, that was in the process of giving birth to a calf. But the calf was stillborn, dead. She was struggling. And the Lamar wolf pack came and very quickly seized her by the throat. It was a quick and violent death, predator prey. We looked again at the carcass of the mother bison, and we could see two coyotes had convened. There was a bevy of ravens and three bald eagles, all scavengers, picking the bones clean. The sun rose. The hackles on the coyotes rose with the sun. The ravens disappeared. The eagles vanished. The coyotes ran. And from the lodgepole forest emerged this beautiful white wolf. The wolf came into where the mother bison's body was and entered that scaffolding of bones, her rib cage. And from our point of view, we could see his flanks and we could watch his belly swell. He must have been inside that cavern for close to a half an hour. When he pulled out, he turned, it was a bib of blood, and then he disappeared as quickly as he came. Again, we looked at that mother bison, bones glistening, and we left. At dusk, we returned to that site wondering if the wolf would also be there. Again, our binoculars, the glimmering bones, her hide, the body of the mother bison, almost gone, save her skeleton. No wolf, no coyotes, just the stillness of the incoming night. About a quarter of a mile, we saw about 300 bison grazing. All at once, we saw a line of seven bison, single file, evenly spaced, walking toward the mother bison. They circled her body once, they circled her body twice, stopped, lowered their heads, nudged her, sniffed her, pawed her body, circled one more time, and then left as they came, single file, evenly spaced, save one lone bison who stayed with her. We are not the only species who lives and breathes and loves and grieves on this planet. Karen Armstrong, a religious scholar, has spent the last part of her life thinking, studying about compassion. What she says is this: compassion is an act. It is not an emotion. But if it were an emotion, it would be most closely aligned with discomfort. Isn't that interesting? Discomfort or disruption? These are uncomfortable times, and I wonder if we can find our own acts of compassion, each in our own way, each in our own time, with the gifts that are ours. I don't mean we stop speaking. I don't mean we stop acting. I mean, can we elevate our consciousness to a state of discomfort where when the right strike moment comes, we can respond. As Emily Dickinson says, life is a spell so exquisite, everything conspires to break it. Michael Naminga's turquoise triangle registered in my heart as sacred rage. Collaborative, not isolated. We can create beauty as a form of resistance. How shall we live? I want to feel both the beauty and the pain of the age we are living in. I want to survive my life without becoming numb. I want to speak and comprehend words of wounding without having these words become the landscape where I dwell. I want to possess a light touch that can elevate darkness to the realm of stars. What is time, sacred time, but the acceleration of consciousness? There are so many ways to change the sentences we have been given. We cannot do it alone. Michael, thank you. We do it alone. Patience, revolution, evolution does come. Voice does come. How shall we live? Once upon a time when women were birds, there was the simple understanding that to sing at dawn and to sing at dusk was to heal the world through joy. The birds still remember what we have forgotten, that the world is meant to be celebrated. A few more thoughts. A last story. We the people have made mistakes. We have made mistakes in our relationships with those who came before us and the land that holds their histories. We have made mistakes in how we have managed and misunderstood the wild. But after spending a lifetime immersed in our public lands, even our national parks, canyonlands, arches, Chaco among them, I believe we are slowly learning what it means to offer our reverence and respect to the closest thing we have to sacred lands. We are at a crossroads. We can continue on the path we have been on in this nation that privileges profit over people and land, or we can unite as citizens with a common cause, the health and wealth of the earth that sustains us. If we cannot commit to this kind of fundamental shift in our relationship to people and place, then democracy becomes another myth perpetuated by those in power who care only about themselves. Our beloved Stuart Udall wrote, quote, "Each generation has its own rendezvous with the land, for despite our fee titles and claims of ownership, we are all brief tenants on this planet. By choice or by default, we will carve out a land legacy for our heirs." The we must include all species. Last story. "It is time to weep and sing," wrote W.H. Auden. At a low ebb of hope, I asked my friend Doug Peacock how he staves off despair. This is the man who kept a map of Yellowstone in the back pocket of his army fatigues throughout the war and would unfold it at night to keep insanity at bay. This is the man, Edward Abbey, crafted George Washington Hayduke after in the Monkey Ranch Gang. Doug said, "Insulate yourself with friends and seek out wild places." Which is exactly what I was doing, seeking out my friend on the other side of Yellowstone on the day we learned that the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service had denied wolverine protection under the Endangered Species Act. While driving from Jackson Hole to Livingston, Montana, I was listening to Vivaldi's Four Seasons, recomposed by the musician Max Richter. I love this piece of music, and I love the story behind it. It was Richter's favorite piece of music. He had played it as a musician hundreds of times and had heard the Four Seasons many more times than he'd ever performed it. But the strangest thing started to occur. The Four Seasons had become so commercialized, so trivialized, played in elevators and as the soundtrack for cheap commercials, that he could no longer hear its beauty. It had become lost to him, demoted to musical wallpaper. Max Richter did the unthinkable. He reimagined Vivaldi's masterpiece and recomposed it so he could hear it once again at this moment in time. He added the bass notes. The Four Seasons, he said, is something we all carry around with us. It's everywhere. In a way, we stop being able to hear it. So this project was about reclaiming this music for me personally. I wanted to fall in love with it all over again. By getting inside it and rediscovering it for myself, he said, I was able to take a new path through a well-known landscape. I was listening to the Four Seasons recomposed as I was en route to Doug. My mind was moving toward reverie with the music. It was exactly what I needed to recompose myself as I was driving through Yellowstone, inspiring me to reimagine everything, including our public lands and national parks. Our institutions and agencies, colleges and universities, government agencies, even our churches, are no longer working for us. It is time to reimagine even the wilderness movement as a movement of direct action. Time to reimagine our public lands as sanctuaries, refuges, and sacred lands. Time to rethink what is acceptable and what is not. I was lost in thought with the music, and then as I was driving through the Hayden Valley, the cars in front of me came to an abrupt halt. Bison jam. Hundreds of bison not only crossing the road, but walking alongside us. I was now at a crawl, barely going 5 miles per hour. I rolled down my window, still listening to the Four Seasons, with a volume much louder than I had realized. The bison started moving closer to my car. I started getting nervous, thought about rolling up my window, but then I began noticing the bison turning their heads toward the music, walking even closer to the car. I imagined they were enjoying Vivaldi as I was, and I relaxed as we listened to the music together for close to a mile, all of us slowly moving down the road. I was late to Doug's house. He was waiting. Impatient, I brought him a nice French Bordeaux. We took the bottle and two glasses outside with a view of Paradise Valley. Doug had written a plea on Wolverine's behalf a week before. It had been published in the Daily Beast. He'd received a note from his editor, Chris Dickey, the son of the poet James Dickey. "I'm sorry," Chris said. "Perhaps this poem from my father will help." Under a thunderous sky with bolts of lightning adding punctuation, Doug and I read The Last Wolverine out loud to each other, between sips of wine alternating between stanzas, with tears streaming down our cheeks. The final lines undid us. Alone, with maybe some dim racial notion of being the last, but none of how much your unnoticed going will mean. How much the timid poem needs the mindless explosion of your rage, the glutton's internal fire, the elk's heart in the belly sprouting wings, the part of the blind swallowing thing with himself to eat the world and not be driven off it until it is gone, even if it takes forever. I take you as you are and make of you what I will, skunk bear, carcajoy, bloodthirsty non-survivor. Lord, let me die, but not die out. Doug and I raised our glasses to the mountains with black clouds billowing all around us, with a swath of red clouds turning pink. To Wolverine, Doug said, with their glasses raised. And then Doug turned to me with tears in his eyes. We lose nothing by loving.